I want to share my success story with you. And when I say success, I don't mean professional success. I get this fulfillment, happiness, with everyday struggles that I do, push the boundaries and the limits of the work that I'm doing. So everyday struggle has actually become my happiness, and which is what I've been trying to do. And I run a small organization called Rat Lab, which I co-founded with my friend and partner, Pradeep. What came across as a small little idea and a passion of two people coming in together to create an organization has actually became the passion. And all of those are passions which kept on building. And all of this comes together now when I run a design technology company, because I learned from there and I built a foundation.
I think architecture for me is about giving life, giving a lifestyle, and setting up cultures for other people. And I think we have a very transformative role to play in the society, because we can actually transform society, we can transform cultures, we can transform behaviors of people, we can transform lifestyles. At the same time, people need to understand what goes behind the scenes to create that. You know, what is the science used to create a small chair, for example?
We use computation as a new method of designing to solve complex problems. And it's just another way of solving design issues in a much more smarter way.
And how we do at Rat Lab, which is the organization I run, is how we operate on data and use that at various scales. So just segmented, very quick glimpse of works at small, medium, large, and extra large scales, product scale, architectural facade, urban scale, and what we are doing at various scales using data. And I can bet after looking at these things, now you can kind of relate to the natural systems and forms that you see around you, and which is what we use and deeply embed in our work as well. Like, this is a bench. It's a fluid bench sectioned in a certain way to more like a natural pattern. Some kind of artwork being created, again using data. And if we are using data to create something, we have the control of how to use that data, how to fabricate that. This is an installation we did last year or last to last year. And the image on the left you see is the skin of a coral. And that's a natural system. So while we are designing it, we can actually do some kind of analysis as well. This is again an installation which we put in one of the malls in Noida. Now this is how fractals happen, how things become faceted in nature. And taking inspiration from that, we've created this interior space, which is used in a subdivision method. And we use a subdivision method to not just design this, but to control the construction process as well. A building facade which we are finishing in Gurgaon. So this, we have moved on to a slightly larger scale. All the facets are again analyzed. The cost was the major parameter in this project, and we really cut down the cost to half using an algorithm.
We are at a time right now where everything is changing. We are in a state of flux right now. Things are moving at a very fast pace. You know, the pace of evolution of technology, of digital technology, so to say, right now is currently at its peak. What we figured out, I mean, what we noticed as a change in the last 200 years is going to happen in the next 20 years. So that is the pace of change, and we need to adapt to that. New things are going to come up, things are going to fail as well. We're going to adapt to certain things, we're not going to adapt to certain things. So I think digital technology is definitely there to stay. It's just going to keep changing its role and meaning and form. So having digital technologies, using a platform, using digital technologies has a lot of potentials. In fact, in our work as well, we use digital technologies right to its potentials and using it in different ways to create smarter aspects.
And that's the whole beauty of nature, that everything comes down to algorithms, codes, and mathematics. So use that code, use those numbers to create something, and create that to create better designs, I would say. And if you don't know how to do that, you can get in touch with us.
I think I've always had this passion for using technology and, you know, how technology can be used in other spectrums and fields, and this is something which really inspired me quite early in my architectural days itself. as architects are not using technology in general, or we are not even researching further. And that is exactly how we thought, okay, research and technology are our keywords, and we need to form a group of independent, you know, thinkers who can come together and form a group, an organization.
So I think for me, a community means when people are coming together to collaborate, to work together, to share their ideas and thoughts. So working together as a community is actually about collaborating on various aspects. When it comes to design and architecture, it is about various people of expertise coming in together, bringing in their expertise, bringing in their knowledge, and sharing it with each other, exchanging a knowledge base, and how that teamwork can actually push the boundaries of the work that we have been doing individually. So, you know, teamwork has a lot more potentials than what individual work carries in itself. So I think that is the whole idea of when a community building happens. People collaborate, people share their ideas, there is an exchange of information, and that gives rise to innovation. This is what I feel always.
On a very larger scale rather, jumping onto a larger scale project, this is a project in Tokyo which we are a part of. It's a shopping center where, which is a collaboration with another Tokyo-based architectural firm, Non-Scale Architects, who commissioned us to design the outer skin of the building. And if you can see the video on the bottom right of the screen, you can pretty much see the anchor points, how we actually use a physics engine, which is in a digital simulation, and allowed us to create these anchor points and lift certain anchor points where we knew the columns would be placed, and made a tensile kind of a structure, which was later comprehended into a digrid structure. As you can see, you can pretty much see it's a digrid structure which is imposed on a tensile kind of fabric, and you can see the environmental analysis on the right hand side. So this is what it looks like from the inside. And all of these panels were actually movable panels, which was programmed based on the climatic information of Tokyo's data, climatic data. Of course, we had a number of consultants on board as well to authenticate the data, and the structural engineers who also could understand the complexity of working on a parametric workflow of the structure. This is a facade project, again, was a collaboration with, and using the word collaboration again, because as I said initially as well, that we delve into collaboration with a lot of architects and designers, and we come in as experts, as computational designers, instead of just being an independent architecture studio as well, where we pretty much take a part of the project or help to facilitate on a certain aspect of the project. In this particular case, the architecture was done by a firm called Design Plus in Delhi, and we were doing the facade of this one. And so the facade is basically typically a faceted kind of a triangular structure, and the whole idea or the principles that we had to intervene was the major parameter was the cost, and how we can make a system which is cost effective, which can help us extract the fabrication drawings and the construction drawings, and which can help us also to train a particular staff on the site to read this drawing and information, because this actually became a very complex looking panel. So we had to reduce the complexity of that. So as you know, as computational designers, we ended up pretty much facilitating the fabricators who had no idea of how to make a complex facade, who were pretty much experts of making simple welding joints. So we again did a simple information of an Excel sheet, getting the point coordinate system, and then using that to find the coordinates to form a particular facade. Transcending to another kind of a scale, these are some roof structure projects we're doing in Hyderabad. With another architectural firm, where you can skip the scale, we pretty much put on a smaller scale to understand the complexity of that, to understand the challenges of that, and detail out every single joint based on the prototype, and the information goes back to our original algorithm. This is one of the very interesting projects. It's a temple, it's a religious project in South India. And interestingly, we were commissioned this with another architectural firm in Chennai, where the client had a very deep connection with numerology. So the idea was that they wanted everything with related to number 11, which pretty much was our project brief, that you have to work with number 11s, and
whatever you do has to go with the number 11. So this is where we found this as an opportunity to club mathematics, algorithms, complexity, sacred geometry, and put this all together to a very interesting architectural morphological exercise. So we ended up understanding and looking at a hendecagon. In fact, a very interesting preview about this project was the area of the site of this project was 11.11 acres. So you can imagine the kind of, the connection with the number 11 that the clients had. So it was a very, very important number that we had to play with. So we ended up researching into a hendecagon, which is an 11-sided polygon. I'm sure it's a new term for most of us. We're not used to an 11-sided polygon. So we had this as a challenge that it had to be symmetrical also, yet it had to have 11 sides. So we pretty much ended up exploring mathematically what are the various kind of two-dimensional formations of the number 11, what all we can do with 11, 121, and various other connotations of the number 11. And ended up creating certain kind of an algorithmic approach where we could do a form-finding exercise which was controlled by us, but facilitated by an algorithm where we could pretty much create a plethora of geometries and start to evaluate and analyze all of that based on structural aspects, climatic aspects, services, constructability, aesthetics, and all of these aspects. So you can see this, all of these are a hendecagon or 11-sided based geometries. And of course, we could explore n number of forms, and this is the top view of the final form that we ended up with, which is a simple origami double fold module kind of a pattern, which is of course at a larger scale, and even the height of that was 11 into 6. That's how we presented this. It was 66 meters large, and even the radius and the diameter, all of that we had to work around with, making sure the proportions and the scale that we are working with is kind of appropriate. This is one of the initial renderings of this one, and this is the interior view, and it's still in development, where you have the idol statue being placed over here, and you can see a very morphed kind of a grid which is also based on number 11. So you always have all of these 11 sides which all had a different kind of a rationale of articulation. And not just how we kind of design our system as well, we end up kind of presenting our works in various kind of methodologies as well. If you can see this video running on the screen, here we are using an augmented reality to present the particular project, and pretty much using a simple mobile phone, you can pretty much get into the 3D model and are able to kind of see from the inside as well how light is going to come in and change the season and all sorts of things as well. So of course, the role of technology is not necessarily only for designing, but how you kind of present and communicate your ideas as well. This was a project where a skyscraper project in Hong Kong, which we won. It was again a collaboration with an architecture firm in Chennai, where we were actually working on a very simple floor plate. I would call it simple now, but of course, after doing a lot of iterations. And then here you can see that we are using an algorithm to define the angle, the twist angle, the number of floors. And just by varying certain kind of parameters, we actually ended up getting a lot of forms. And then we started to analyze all of these forms and started to design the building skin on the facade of this particular one. And every single window that you see over here is actually devised in a manner. It is differentiated in a manner, but it is devised in a manner which is very much connected to the climatic information of how we want the sun to enter in, how we want the daylight to enter into the floor plates, how we want the radiation to kind of go in, and all sorts of other things. Talking of another collaboration where we developed and another aspect in usage of computational design, we developed this tool for IIT Gandhinagar project which you worked on, where the tool allowed us to, it's a computational tool which allowed us to understand the visibility of every single space in an urban fabric, which ended up defining the safety condition, visibility conditions in a hospital. This was another collaboration with a Bangalore-based firm. VA Group, one of the proposals for Infosys, where We ended up defining a TAR, which was based on the how people move inside the space, how the office space has to be much more efficient. Of course, I can't show all kind of details of the output of the project, but just showing you the intention of how technology played a key role in forming the various kind of analysis.
We as architects are not using technology in general, or we are not even researching further. And that is exactly how we thought, okay, research and technology are our keywords, and we need to form a group of independent, you know, thinkers who can come together and form a group. And we were also inspired by DRL program, which is not what we studied, which is design research lab. So the whole idea of lab and the whole laboratory culture was very fascinating to us. I think there are a lot of workflows that we have created in terms of tools. Yeah, of course, we released one very sweet and useful and cheesy tool, which was called SpiroRack. It's a free to use tool where one can create mathematical patterns, simple, complex, and create shapes. And we decided to release that to a lot of friends and artists and architects. We created the visibility of an auditorium, which is for a project we worked on with ArcOp architects. It allows you to calculate the visibility of every single seat in an auditorium. Another few tools have been working on spatial analysis and studies when we had started, right, where we can evaluate a plan, optimize a plan and a layout of an office space, which we were doing and consulting on. This was a project in London. It became a good testing ground for us, and we started to look into that when we started this OYO project last year. The next tool we recently created was we can calculate the amount of machine time that a CNC milling machine will use to fabricate the whole facade. So, you know, getting the cost from a fabricator has become very easier. It's helping in the workflow. And these are all internal in-house developed tools and workflows. But this is like high-end computation. This is exactly the future of computation. In fact, I hate to say this, but it's not the future. It's actually the present. We need to adapt to that now, because people outside of India, let's say globally, have been doing that for the last 10 years.
This is an upcoming and ongoing project. I just have the visuals for this one, which is a large scale roof structure that we're designing. Again, a collaboration with a firm in Delhi, Creators Architects, where it's a triple skinned roof structure, which has particular certain kind of functions. And the interesting part is the fin-like language that you see over here. So you can pretty much see a metallic weaving, which ends up creating a certain kind of morphology or a form on this kind of a pure geometry. So of course, this slide particularly shows the complexity of how every single grid is actually rationalized and resolved geometrically. And that is pretty much done on the entire skin. And then we understand the radiation, how this is kind of getting the heat, what is the kind of temperature inside the space, and all these kind of principles pretty much go back into defining a system. This is from a facade project which you're working on, and the interesting part that you can see is, although it seems like a very complex looking facade, you can see this diagram over here, which pretty much shows us three colors. So essentially there are four colors that you see over here. So there are just four kind of modules, A, B, C, and D, which are pretty much put together to create this kind of an interesting formation. And of course, this formation differs on how this facade is, placed on the west direction and on the south direction and the north direction and the east direction of the building. So pretty much you have the same modules being placed on all sides of buildings, but at the same time, you can vary the kind of modules, making sure that you cut down the unnecessary glare and sunlight, and program this facade accordingly, which is what you can see in this particular image as well, as you can see A, B, C, and D. So of course, rather than just designing it, we obviously program till the fabrication stage.
Is our education adaptive enough? How are we adapting to change? Now, the first thing that comes to my mind when it comes to adapting to something new is technology.
There are voids in the system, in the education system, how technology is implemented in architecture. The idea is to how to use, take these voids as an opportunity to create something new. Within architecture as well, we have certain kind of voids that have been evolved as our buildings and architecture has evolved with time.
You know, there are a lot of loopholes in the system that we have currently, and I think a lot of designers and architects have now stepped forward to take responsibility of that and trying to fix that in our own small and big ways.
I have been working with a couple of colleges to write a new curriculum, but the moment we start to do that, we realize there's nobody to teach that. The only way to prove something wrong or prove your point right is to create a parallel system and build that up and make that talk for itself. And there are two important things which can happen at that time. Either you will prove the other system wrong and prove yourself right, which is a good thing, but even better when you fail. And if you fail and you realize that the system was actually right, you learn a lot through that process. That we don't have to have a physical school in one space, we're restricting ourselves. It's based on an idea, it's based on a thought which can run anywhere in the country and cater to any kind of students and professionals. And we've kind of traveled across different countries and cities to do these modules, and which ranges from 2-day studios to 6-month programs. So 2015 we started these sessions in various cities called Smart Lab.
Now this entire school is independent. We do not have a physical space, so to say. It runs on an idea.
I am very hopeful of a change which is going to happen and is happening. We had a mixed batch of students. We had architects, we had interior designers, we had interactive artists as well, who created their whole interactive installations and brought in their expertise into the studio. And these students are now going to be teaching in the second batch. So we're able to create that platform to connect everyone and to make education accessible for all.
You know, brain is very, very powerful, much more powerful than what we can imagine. So it does adapt pretty well to a lot of situations, and we can continue to learn. So I would just say that embrace technology that is available right now, because you never know what the future holds for us, technology or no technology.